I want to begin this morning by telling you that I was looking at some of my preaching resources, and I came across some information of some preachers who had collected some conversations that happened right at the exit door to the sanctuary, and some of the funny things that people say to preachers when they're leaving the sanctuary. So I wanted to share a couple of those with you, and one of those went like this. It was a conversation after a sermon. There was a guest organist that day, and the organist says, "Did you go to seminary?" And the preacher said, "Oops. Yes, I did." And the organist said, "Well, did you graduate?" And let me say for the record, I went to seminary and graduated, for the record. Next one. "The Lord healed me of insomnia during that sermon. Thank you." Next one. "Each one of your sermons is better than the next." Now think about that one. Just think about it. And then the last one I wanted to share with you. "That was a great sermon. And don't ever speak to me like that again." Actually, this is the one I wanted to camp on here for just a second. Because sometimes the Word of God comes to us with a poke, doesn't it? And we don't necessarily like the poke, but sometimes we know that we need the poke. I used to work with a pastor at the New Era Church, and he said to me on a somewhat regular basis, or occasional basis anyway, "You were meddling on Sunday." Would we want God to meddle with us? I think we do. It may be painful, it may be difficult at times, but I think we want to invite God to meddle. In fact, it's in that spirit that I want to invite us to pray right now as we turn to the Word. Spirit of God, come. We confess that we are lost, we are broken, we are sinful. And we need you to meddle in our hearts and in our minds and in our lives and our relationships. Meddle with us today, Spirit of God. Speak your truth and give us an ability to understand and to hear and to respond in faith. Speak to us, for we are listening. Amen. So we're in this sermon series throughout these summer months called Something Old, Something New, lifting up some prominent figures from the Old Testament, drawing out from those Old Testament figures some biblical truth, seeing where that same truth turns up in Jesus' ministry and in the life of the early church, and seeing how that connects to us, something old and something very new. That's what our hope is when we do this. And some highlights of the story so far, and let me just say as I do this, I'm convinced and convicted that we are becoming more and more a biblically illiterate culture. And so it's always important to sort of set the stage, particularly with portions of the scriptures that we are not familiar with. And that is probably no more true than with the Old Testament and with some of the stuff that we'll be sharing today. So highlights of the story so far, we see God in the Genesis accounts creating everything. The sin virus enters creation and begins to degrade and erode what God intended. And it gets to the point where God says, "Whoa, I need to wipe the slate clean." And so the Noah story comes. There's a sense in which that Noah narrative is a wiping of the slate clean. But that sin virus is still there. People begin to multiply, and God says, "Okay, I'm going to do a different tactic here for dealing with the sin in the world. I'm going to bless this family, Abraham and Sarah and their descendants, and through them all of the families of the earth will be blessed, and I'll eventually lead them to a promised land, and they will inherit that land. But this is the means now, the mechanism by which I'm going to change the world." Well, the people began to multiply, and eventually they found themselves in slavery. And God heard their cries. He raised up Moses to go down and deliver them from their slavery. And eventually Moses turns over the reins of leadership to Joshua. And Joshua leads them across the Jordan River now to do battle and take possession of the Promised Land. And it's here in the Promised Land, now that they have come to take possession of it, they are surrounded by these pagan nations, these pagan influences, and there's a whole new set of challenges that come here in the book of Judges. And that really is the setup for what we are talking about this morning. Still setting the stage here by looking at Judges 2. We're actually going to talk about Gideon in Judges 6, but let me further set the stage for what's going on here in the book of Judges by reading these verses from Judges 2. After that whole generation had been gathered to their ancestors, another generation grew up who knew neither the Lord nor what he had done for Israel. Then the Israelites did evil in the eyes of the Lord and served the Baals. Now let me pause there for a second. They are looking at the pagan religion of those cultures around them, and they say, well, we have this relationship with God, but maybe we can cover our bases by bowing to that idol over there as well, and just try to run the board here. And that's not how God operates, is he? They forsook the Lord, the God of their ancestors, who had brought them out of Egypt. They followed and worshipped various gods of the peoples around them. They aroused the Lord's anger. One thing that we sense here in the book of Judges is the holiness of God. The Lord hates sin. God is not like a benevolent uncle who winks at the niece or the nephew when they steal a cookie from the cookie jar. God hates sin. And we see that in that phrase, they aroused the Lord's anger. So what we see going on here in the book of Judges is the repeated unfaithfulness of the Israelites. In fact, that one phrase from Judges 2 that I read just a moment ago, the Israelites did evil in the sight of the Lord, that phrase, that very sentence construction appears 7 times in the book of Judges. Oh, and again, the Israelites did evil in the sight of the Lord. They did evil in the sight of the Lord. And when you get into the book of Kings, you see this again and again. This king did evil in the sight of the Lord, and this king did evil in the sight of the Lord. So we'll unpack a little bit about what that means. We also see God's readiness to withdraw his hand of providence and protection, because there's a sense in which, in this story that we're going to read, that when God's people do evil in his sight and they ignore his call to repent and to be faithful to him and him alone, when they harden their hearts to him, God pulls back and says, okay, if you want to live that way, there are some consequences that are going to happen. And if you're not going to listen to my voice now, maybe you'll listen for my voice after you live with some of those consequences. So God withdraws his sense of coddling them and says, if you disobey, there will be some consequences that come with that. But we also see God's people then crying out for aid and assistance. That's what happens in this story that we're going to read. And then we also then see in the book of Judges God raising up a small handful of special leaders who are empowered by the Spirit of God to lead God's people in a particular time, in a particular place, out of some jam that they've gotten themselves in. This is what the book of Judges is about, God raising up those individuals to fill that kind of role. Most of the time we think of a judge wearing a black robe and a gavel. That's not what this is about. This is God raising up those individuals to serve in that capacity. And really, this is a story that highlights the role of the Spirit of God. If there is a book in the Old Testament that correlates to the book of Acts in the New Testament, where we see the Holy Spirit doing some wonderful, powerful stuff in the life of the early church, it's the Spirit of God that comes on these certain individuals. And time and again it says, and the Spirit of God came upon whoever this it is that we're talking about, and they did something amazing. So this really is about the equipping and the empowering of the Holy Spirit. Maybe one last comment about the book of Judges. This is a season, if you've not spent much time in the Old Testament, this is a time in the Old Testament where there is a great deal of bloodshed and violence. And there's just no way to get around that. I remember once a dear friend of mine, Larry Vanderplatz, did Year of the Bible, and he read that, and he got done reading that, and he says, I cannot believe how much bloodshed I have read in the Old Testament. And really, I don't want to soft pedal that, but let's just acknowledge it for what it is. When there's an evil world and people are living apart from God's ways, it's not going to go well. There's going to be a lot of stuff that happens like that. So now we're getting close to Judges 6 and 7, where we're going to be reading today. And the character of Gideon, and the story of Gideon, if you know that, that's probably one of the better known stories from the book of Judges, is that they were being harassed and had all kinds of problems, the Israelites did, with this country of the Midianites. And God raised up Gideon to go defeat the Midianites. And the way they did it is God said, hey, your army is too big. You got to winnow your army down to just 300 people. You're going to surround the encampment of Midianites, and you're all going to have these clay pots and break them all at the same time and blow the horn. And the Midianites are going to be completely confused, and they're going to start slashing at each other. And that's what happened. The Midianites were destroyed by themselves. In the midst of all of that. But really, what we're talking about is not that story, but the story before the story. God coming to Gideon and speaking to Gideon and raising him up. So I want to take a look at Judges 6. And there's a lot of verses in Judges 6. And we could take all day to preach on every verse in Judges 6, but I'm going to be merciful to you all and pick out some selected verses from this chapter and tell this story of what was going on here with Gideon. So beginning with verse 1. The Israelites did evil in the eyes of the Lord, and for 7 years he gave them into the hands of the Midianites. When the Israelites cried out to the Lord because of Midian, he sent them a prophet who said, this is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says. I brought you up out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. I rescued you from the hand of the Egyptians, and I delivered you from the hand of your oppressors. I drove them out before you and gave you their land. I said to you, I am the Lord your God. Do not worship the gods of the Amorites, in whose land you live. But you have not listened to me. When the angel of the Lord appeared to Gideon, he said, the Lord is with you, mighty warrior. Pardon me, my lord, Gideon replied. But if the Lord is with us, why has all this happened to us? Where are all his wonders that our ancestors told us about when they said, did not the Lord bring us up out of Egypt? But now the Lord has abandoned us and given us into the hands of Midian. The Lord turned to him and said, go in the strength you have and save Israel out of Midian's hand. Am I not sending you? Pardon me, my lord, Gideon replied, but how can I save Israel? My clan is the weakest in Manasseh, and I am the least in my family. The Lord answered, I will be with you. That same night, I'm skipping ahead now to verse 25, that same night, the Lord said to him, that is Gideon, take the second bull from your father's herd, the one 7 years old, tear down your father's altar to Baal and cut down the Asherah pole beside it. Then build a proper kind of altar to the Lord your God on the top of this height, using the wood of the Asherah pole that you cut down after the second bull as a offer the second bull as a burnt offering. The people of the town demanded of Joash, that is Gideon's father, bring out your son. They're angry because he did this. Bring out your son. He must die because he has broken down Baal's altar and cut down the Asherah pole beside it. So let's talk about this passage. What do we see going on in here? And what does God want us to see about the truth that is coming from this story? And at some level, I think it's important for us to see the speeds of human brokenness. What do I mean by that? We are quick to repeat the sins of the past. The Israelites did evil in the sight of the Lord. This phrase comes up again and again and again in the Old Testament. And it's as if each generation needs to relearn, yeah, we're pretty messed up. Yeah, we need the Lord. So they're quick to repeat the sins of the past. They're quick to forget. They're slow to remember what God has done for them. And it says they are slow to repent. Did you notice in verse 1? It says that Midian had been messing with the Israelites for how long? 7 years. You would think that there would have been somebody in the group that would have said, time out. Maybe we need a different plan here. But they were participating in this Baal worship and this Asherah worship, and they thumbed their nose at the Lord, and God said, there are consequences that are going to come. So they are quick to fall into the same pattern and slow to repent. And I hope you see that this really is not just an exercise of our interpreting Scripture, but Scripture interpreting us. The Bible helps us understand ourselves, that we are broken, that we tend to reach for the wrong things, and that we are quick to repeat mistakes that have happened before us, and we are slow to repent when those things happen. I think the Bible, God wants to show us that truth from the Bible this morning. Secondly, it speaks to us of the permissive will of God. Again, verse 1, and for 7 years he gave them into the hands of the Midianites. The permissive will of God. Here Gideon is saying, God's abandoned us. And God's saying, well, you abandoned me, right? I'm going to permit you to live with the consequences of your choices here, because if you're not going to listen to me now, perhaps you will listen to me after you're experiencing some of your own brokenness and the results that come from the choices that you have made. I think God allows us, when we harden our heart to Him, He speaks to us, calls us to Himself, but then sometimes lets us live with the consequences of the choices we have made, because sometimes we won't listen until that happens. Those of you who know my own spiritual pilgrimage might remember times when I have said that when I was 16 years old, I thumbed my nose at God, I thumbed my nose at my family, I thumbed my nose at my basketball coaches and what everyone else was expecting of me, and I went and partied in high school, and I got myself in a pile of trouble. And that all came to a head when I was arrested for drunk driving at the age of 16. And I think God was trying to get my attention before then. But because I wasn't listening, God said, okay, maybe there needs to be something else that happens here that's going to get His attention. So He permitted me. I could have cried out, God, why did you let me get arrested? And God said, whoa. You were running the show right there for a while. God permits that in order for there to be a larger story that He's going to tell. I think that happens not just with individuals, but with churches. When Sherry and I were on vacation in the first part of May, I read this book by Tom Rainer called This Autopsy of a Deceased Church. And Tom Rainer has gone through and studied all kinds of churches that have closed their doors because they did not have a sustainable ministry anymore. And interestingly, the one strongest variable that was consistent with every one of the churches that he looked at was that those churches that closed their doors, had turned inward. It became all about us, our songs, our style of worship, the stuff that we like, the stuff that we want to have happen in the way that we want it. Never mind paying attention to the community around them and trying to have a meaningful connection and relationship with the people right here within the ministry footprint. They turned inward. And so we live in a country today where this year, between 3,000 and 4,000 churches will close their doors. And Tom Rainer would say, primarily because they have turned inward. And it's almost as if my discernment tells me, God says, the way that church is operating is not my mission. And so there are some consequences that come from turning inward, and that is their churches are not reproducing. And if that means that they end up dying, well, there's something permissive that's happening there. Some churches may cry out and say, why is this happening? Why, God, are you causing us to falter? God said, I had nothing to do with your faltering. You were doing that really quite well all on your own. Right? This is the permissive will of God. And we would do well to pay attention to that. But the good news is that God is writing a larger story for that. Even in our failures, we can have faith. Romans 8:28, and we know that in all things, not just some things, but in all things, God works for the good of those who love him. It's not like we seek out failure, but when we do, when we stub our toe, when we stumble, God uses even that. And that's a statement of faith for us, to believe that God is even going to use the times when we stumble for his glory and his story and his purpose. Thirdly, the persistent will of God, not just the permissive will, but now the persistent will of God. Here the Israelites had once again done evil in the sight of the Lord, and God sort of withdraws and they live with the consequences of that. But God doesn't leave them there. He keeps his eye on them and he intervenes. Verse 7, when the Israelites cried out to the Lord because of Midian, he sent them a prophet. And then in verse 12, he sends them an angel who now comes to Gideon and raises up this judge, this leader, who's going to get them out of this situation. God does not take his eye off of the story here, even though it might feel like that from time to time. This is the persistent will of God, and he is watching, and he will intervene. And really, this is a story about God's patience as well. And it reminds me of what it says in 2 Peter 3:9. The Lord is patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. God is going to have his eye on us and be intervening in such a way that he wants to draw us to himself, even as we stumble. The fourth thing, God sees us for what we can be, and there's an asterisk next to the word be. God sees us for what we can be, not for what we are or have been. That angel of the Lord comes alongside Gideon and calls him mighty warrior. We don't know a thing about Gideon's resume up to this point. He's not demonstrated that he's a soldier, that he's a warrior. And yet that angel comes and refers to him as mighty warrior. Because God sees Gideon for what Gideon can be by God's strength, by his power of his spirit, and by his grace. Right? So that's the asterisk. It's not just a feel-good message for Gideon. Oh, Gideon, you don't need the Lord. You've got everything you need. No, that's not true. By God's grace and by the power of his spirit, God's angel can come alongside Gideon and refer to him as a mighty warrior. And I think that this truth, that God sees us for who we can be by his grace and by the power of his spirit, carries through to the New Testament when Jesus says to the disciples on the Sea of Galilee, come and follow me. Because I believe I can see that by my grace and by the power of my spirit, you can become fishers of men and women and children for the kingdom of God. He didn't see them as being what they were, but he saw them for what they could be. They were just fishermen, but he saw their potential with his grace and spirit involved in the equation. Or think about Jesus interacting with Peter after Peter on the high wire failed. He denied Jesus three times. Jesus didn't come and rub his nose in it and say, oh, you're a three-time loser, Peter, for denying me. Jesus, in his resurrected form, comes to Peter and he says, I have a role for you. I want you to feed my sheep, take care of my people. I want you to be a leader. Jesus saw that potential by his grace and his spirit to be at work in Peter. And the last thing I would want us to see, and this is the one where God really started to stir something up in me, private repentance precedes public effectiveness. In verse 25, the angel says to Gideon, tear down your father's altar to Baal and cut down the Asherah pole beside it. Now think about this for a minute. God was going to do something miraculous in defeating the Midianites. And God did not want that, the success of that battle being attributed to Baal or to Asherah. In fact, God wanted those things to be put away altogether. So he instructs Gideon to tear down the altar to Baal and to tear down the Asherah pole. Because when God shows up the next day in that battle and defeating the Midianites, he wants that glory to come to himself. He wants the story told correctly. It was not because of Baal, and it was not because of Asherah. And so Gideon repents privately before there can be public effectiveness in defeating Midian. And this call to repentance, again, is something that turns up in the New Testament, Acts 20. I've declared to both Jews and Greeks that they must turn to God in repentance and have faith in our Lord Jesus Christ. There is always a call to be people who turn to the Lord, who turn away from those things that would lead us away from the Lord, and to turn to the Lord. And think about what that means for us in our mission here at Fifth Reformed Church. Over the last 8 months or so, we have gained clarity. I love our mission statement, that God is calling us to help people discover and follow Jesus. And I think many of us are beginning to pray that the Lord will bring a wave of fruitfulness, new believers that will just glorify God and change the character of this place. We're praying for that to happen. But if Gideon's story teaches us anything, there may be some things that we need to repent of, some Asherah poles and some Baal altars that we need to tear down before we're going to see that wave of ministry fruitfulness come. I wanted to share with you some of the language that we're learning to live with at the leadership level. As we're faithful in helping people discover and follow Jesus, we know that we're going to need to gather as the family of God. We know we're going to need to grow as followers of Jesus, and we're going to need to go as friends of Jesus' mission. We know all of those things, but the result that we are hoping for and praying for is that we will do these things so that there will be new disciples and renewed disciples of Jesus. Because it's not just about reaching the people in our community. It's about the people who are here, the person who is sitting in your seat and my spot, all of us being renewed. And how does that happen? We are renewed by this invitation that comes to us. Yes, we have to say yes to following Jesus, but we also have to say no to anything that gets in the way of following Jesus. Like Gideon, we need to tear down the Baal altars and the Asherah poles. We need to engage in some private repentance before there will be public effectiveness. So what are some modern altars to Baal and Asherah? We talked about this as a staff. And granted, there may not be the little statues of the various gods that are idols, but there are idols in our world, are there not? The idols of money, the idols of military power, the idols of, selfishness, the idols of individualism, idols of control, any recovering control freaks here. I'm one. We like to be in charge, don't we? I want to call the shots. I think there's a control idol that we may need to get away from and repent of. Treasured traditions. Churches can get stuck with treasured traditions, and so where the way that we've always done it becomes the mantra for everything. Personal preferences can become idols. We've got idols of family. Yes, family can become idolatrous if God ends up taking a second seat. Our social lives can become idolatrous. Our sexuality can become idolatrous because it leads us, if used improperly, leads us away. I want to put a hard stop in the message right here for a minute. Because there have been a couple stories that have come out on MLive in the last couple of months that have been deeply, deeply troubling to me. And on our side of town, we live down in Norton Shores, you might have read some of these things. I know personally of two families who run in some of the same circles that our family has run in with regard to sports and such. Two families that have nearly been destroyed because of men who have misused and made some bad choices with regard to their own sexuality. And I want to call out the men in this church, if I can, for just a minute. Because there's some junk going on. And it's leading away from the Lord. And the Lord may pull back and say, well, there may be a consequence that comes with that. But I hope you see that this word that is being spoken right now is a word of mercy. To repent now, because that will be exposed. There will be some destructive stuff that comes to you and your family if you continue down this path. God is merciful by giving you this moment and to repent of that. So I want to call the men in particular of this church to hear that message and to repent. Licentiousness, or the idol of sports. Any sports idolatrous people out there consumed by the various sports, either as a participant or a watcher of sports? I think it's even possible to make the Bible an idol. Words on a page, we can become so obsessed with words on a page that we lose track of the fact that these words on a page invite us into a relationship with the Father in heaven. We can become so consumed with those words on the page that we lose the relationship. I think our politics can become idolatrous, or our addictions, because they all bring a destructive kind of influence to our lives. So where does that leave us? That leaves us with a clicker. I'm going to get a new one of these things, I'll tell you that. Where does that leave us today? At the end of this message, at the end of this worship experience, I'm going to be standing out there. And quite frankly, I don't care what you have to say to me when you walk out of the building today. I don't. What I care the most about is, have you heard from the Lord this morning? Are you allowing God to meddle in your stuff? Because that is what God wants to deal with today. Our stuff. The stuff that we need to turn away from. Yes, we need to say yes to Jesus and following Him, but that also means saying no to some other stuff. So I think the story of Gideon would bring us to that place of private repentance before public effectiveness. And that God is inviting that. God is inviting us into that kind of an experience. We're going to close the service today with the praise team leading us in the singing of Holy Spirit. And one of the teachings of the scriptures about the Holy Spirit is, yes, the Holy Spirit brings peace and comfort, but there are times when the Holy Spirit brings a word of conviction. And I think this is one of those days where we need to be aware of where some of our Asherah poles are and our Baal altars are. We need to tear those things down. Because this matters. It matters for you personally. It matters for your family. It matters to the ministry of this church. And ultimately, it matters to the mission of God, of helping people discover and follow Jesus. Let's pray. Father God, thank you for your truth. Holy Spirit, thank you for this convicting presence that you bring us today. I pray, Father, that we may be receptive, that we may not only hear your voice, but be motivated to repent. Yes, to say yes to you, but to say no to anything that would pull us away from you. God, move us in your direction. God, do that work in us which only you can do. Meddle with us. We ask this in Jesus' name.